reading of our church covenant drafted in 1955. Having been led, as we believe, by the Spirit of God to receive the Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior, and on the profession of our faith, having been baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, we do now, in the presence of God and this assembly, most solemnly and joyfully enter into covenant with one another. We covenant by the aid of the Holy Spirit to love our neighbors as ourselves, to strive for the advancement of this church in knowledge, holiness, and comfort, to promote its prosperity and spirituality, to sustain its worship, ordinances, discipline, and doctrines, to contribute cheerfully and regularly to the support of the ministry, the expenses of the church, the relief of the poor, and the spread of the gospel through all nations. We engage to maintain family and private devotion, to educate our children in the Christian faith, to seek the salvation of our children in the Christian faith, to seek the salvation of our kindred and acquaintances, to walk circumspectly in the world, to be just in our dealings, faithful in our engagements, and exemplary in our deportment, to practice moderation in all things, and to be zealous in our efforts to advance the kingdom of our Savior. We engage to watch over one another in Christian love, to remember each other in prayer, to aid each other in sickness and distress, to cultivate Christian sympathy and courtesy in speech. We moreover engage that when we remove from this place, we will unite with some other church as soon as possible, where we will carry out the spirit of this covenant and the principles of God's word.
Hear now these words as our call to worship today. The foolish say, there's no God. We're alone. We're on our own. But today we gather to declare the glory of God in our lives. The foolish say, it's your life. You're accountable to no one. But today we gather strengthened by the Spirit and trusting that Christ dwells in our hearts. The foolish say, everything I have is mine. I owe nothing to anyone. But today we gather to praise the one who calls us to serve others in love. Would you bow with me in prayer? Let's pray. This day, O God, as we gather virtually, but with heart and soul focused on you, and actually in the presence of the King of Kings, grant us the ability to not only know you, but to trust in the difference that you make in our lives, not only in this day, but for all eternity. For our prayer is in Jesus' name. Amen.
In the presence of a holy God, I bow down and I adore. You reveal the secrets of my heart, and I am shaken to the core. In the presence of a holy God, there's new God, how awesome. so small and frail and weak. When I see your power and wisdom, Lord, I have no words left to speak. In the presence of your glory, my crowns lie in the dust. You are righteous in your judgments, Lord. You are faithful, true, and just. And I cry, holy, holy, holy God, how majestic is your reign, and I am changed in the presence of a holy God. Holy, holy, holy of a holy God.
Good morning. Today we celebrate a special day. We celebrate the anniversary of our church, Markham Baptist. Today we celebrate 65 years in worship together. The definition of anniversary is the date on which an event took place in a previous year. We celebrate a lot of anniversaries. We celebrate birthdays. We celebrate the day people get married. We celebrate the day that God sent his son Jesus to earth to live among us. We celebrate Jesus's death. But today, I want to focus our celebration on the birth of our church, the place that we gather every Sunday, whether it's in the comfort of our homes or in the comfort of the pews inside our building. We are so thankful to have you all as part of our worship today. We are thankful for the blessing that is our building, and we are thankful for each and every person that comes through the doors. Unfortunately, we are celebrating from the comfort of our home today and not celebrating inside our building. But that doesn't make it any less special of a day, and it is one that we should celebrate. So please join with me in celebration of our church. Bow with me in prayer. Dear God, we're so thankful for the many blessings that you have given to us, including this building, Markham Baptist. Lord, we are so thankful to be able to have celebrated and worshiped with you in this building for the last 65 years. Lord, we are excited to continue that tradition of celebrating and worshiping you in this place. Lord, we may be separated in our own homes, because of the coronavirus, but Lord, we are still so thankful for all that you've given to us, for the blessings, the encouragement, and the love that we feel each and every Sunday that we gather alongside our fellow members and attendees at Markham Baptist. Lord, as we dive into our service today, may we remember this celebration, the celebration of your Son, the gift that you gave with the death of his. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.
Listen to the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, written by Matthew in chapter 25, verses 31 to 46. When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people one from another, like a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at the left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, "Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me." Then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you?" And the king will answer them, "Truly, I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these, who are members of my family, you did it to me." Then he will say to those on his left hand, "You are accursed. Depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not give me clothing. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me." Then they also will answer, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or sick or in prison and did not take care of you?" Then he will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me." And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. These are the words of our Lord. Thanks be to God.
Church anniversaries, they normally come with banquets and speeches. But with COVID here, we're hoping to host a virtual gathering a few Sundays from now. And we invite you to tune into Zoom to participate in the activities. Anniversary speeches often include some looking ahead and looking back. Looking back with thanksgiving as we remember where we've come from, but also looking ahead with a sense of anticipation, if not trepidation, around how we're going to get there. When Queen Elizabeth was a girl, she witnessed the fear in her father's eyes as he was unexpectedly thrust onto center stage of world history. It was following his brother's abdication of the throne. King George VI wasn't known as a great speaker. He stammered and stuttered. His great thoughts simply fell to the ground with a lack of conviction. There was a movie made about his rule over Britain and how it was revived with the help of an unorthodox speech therapist. And in one scene from that movie, Lionel, his teacher, lounges on St. Edward's throne. Now that's the ancient chair upon which British monarchs throughout time sat when being crowned. But seeing him seated casually there, Colin Firth, who plays the part of the new king, stammers out, "You can't sit there, listen to me." But enjoying one more opportunity to get under the skin of the king, Lionel replies, "Why should I listen to you?" To which the king shouts back, "Because I have a voice." How we use our voice and what we give voice to points to the values of our lives. A good thing to consider on this anniversary Sunday, as Christ's church, it helps us to understand what Jesus valued. They show up here in Matthew 25, his values. We're just a chapter away from Jesus' Last Supper, and we're a chapter away from Gethsemane. We're one chapter before Jesus' arrest and trial before the Sanhedrin. And a mere two chapters separate this conversation from the cross that he'll be crucified on come Friday. What Matthew recounts here is the culminating moment in Jesus' teaching. It sums up the major themes of Matthew's gospel. Matthew's all about showing us Jesus as the anointed one, the king. And it tells us this king, above all others, has a voice. And he wishes to tell us something that might very well change our lives. When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory, and all the nations will be gathered before him. And he will separate people, one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand, and the goats at his left. And then the king will say to those at his right hand, "Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom that's prepared for you from the foundation of the world." In the first three verses, Jesus is presented in three ways: as the Son of Man, as shepherd, and as king. Jesus, who in Matthew 8 had nowhere to lay his head, is now seated on the royal throne as king. Jesus, who in Matthew 12 was accused of being an agent of Satan, is now revealed as the Lord of Lords. And Jesus, who in Matthew 13 was rejected, even in his hometown, is now exalted as judge over all humanity. And Jesus, who in Matthew 4 resisted every temptation presented to him, is now commanding the very angels of heaven. The voice of the king, Matthew tells us, comes like a blast, summing up what Jesus has taught throughout Matthew's gospel. And it bears not one, but two surprises. There are two separate audiences listening to this king's speech. One is commended for actions that had simply overflowed out of the character of their lives. While I was in Scotland a few years ago, I attended worship one Sunday at St. Giles Cathedral in Edinburgh. I walked up to admire that beautiful pulpit there and noticed something. In the design and intricate patterns of that piece of ecclesiastical furniture are images from verses 35 to 36 from Matthew 25. There are scenes from the judgment of the sheep and the goats. "For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me." So it was for the first grouping. The second grouping is judged with identical language, only with an entirely opposite application. One is invited in to claim their royal inheritance. The other is ushered out of the presence of the king. And we all know which group we would like to be in. And if we stop here, if this is all there is to this passage, that those who do good deeds are rewarded and those who do not are punished, then it would be just like any other morality tale. It would be the sort of story we could find in any religious literature anywhere. But that's not all there is. Jesus' two audiences don't know what's about to be said to either of them. Both are caught off guard by his pronouncement. The sheep have no idea that in their compassion to people in need, they're providing a ministry to Christ. And also the same for the goats. They have not a clue that in their indifference, they're in fact neglecting Christ. Both groups are stunned, and both ask, when? When was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison? When was that exactly? This passage isn't saying if you simply take some change out of your pocket and put it in the Salvation Army kettle, by the time the coins hit the bottom, you're guaranteed entrance into heaven. Truly I tell you, says Jesus, just as you did it for one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it for me. Now, the most common interpretation of the phrase least of these is that they are all who are in need. Christians are not to be part of the power elite. We're not meant to be the moral majority forcing our will on others. We are those who identify with the weak and with the impoverished, with the disenfranchised and the marginalized. The great preacher and scholar Haddon Robinson, in one of his lectures, imagines himself standing before the King, the risen Christ, who asks him, did you bring your date book? Look up March 6, 1996. Oh yes, I remember that, Lord. That's when Newsweek said that I was one of the better communicators in the English world. I remember that. And the King says back, well, I never read the news magazines. You know how inaccurate they are that they would say something like that about you. The King might say, do you remember after class on that day? You were headed for another appointment and there was a young woman sitting at the back of the class. She just sat there when everyone else left and you stopped and talked to her. She said that her father had died and the month before her brother had died. And you sat and talked to her. Do you remember that? I guess I do, Lord. And the King will say, I remember it. When you stopped to talk to that young woman, you were talking to me, and I've never forgotten it. When we come to that last judgment, there are going to be all kinds of surprises for all of us. This is not a humanitarian call to work on behalf of the undervalued, as if salvation were something that we achieve through good works. But this is Jesus giving us the good news, that salvation is something we often discover when we least expect it. The righteous are surprised to realize they had cared for the King of creation, as much as the unrighteous are shocked that they had missed so many opportunities to show love to the King. Had they only known that God was right there, they would have done the right thing then. So the righteous are surprised because they're simply sharing who they are without expectation. Isaiah, some 700 years before Jesus' birth, had pointed him out. There was nothing beautiful or majestic about his appearance, nothing to attract us to him. He was despised and rejected, a man of sorrows and acquainted with deepest grief, says Isaiah 53. As the Church of Christ, where do we fit in? What do you suppose God would say to Markham Baptist Church in 2020? COVID-19 has certainly taken us all by surprise. But I'm wondering what surprises will God have in store for us? What is it that's coming naturally to you and me during this pandemic? Are we becoming more hard-hearted or tender-hearted to those who live with or are separated from us? Are we more attuned or more distracted because of the needs around us? Are we less demanding or less patient? Are we more discouraged or more hopeful by the things we can't control? Are we less inspired or less disillusioned. What the king is looking for is not moments of inspired living, but lives inspired by Christ and overflowing with the love and mercy, the forgiveness of God, which comes naturally to us. You see, the next time you notice something that causes you to pause, even for a moment, don't let that moment pass without looking into the eyes of Christ and doing what you'd naturally want to do for Him. And if by chance, like every one of us, you happen not to notice Him on some occasion, then be assured He'll be back, even if it is to give us all another moment to realize that God has not overlooked us. And in fact, God knows the needs of your heart even now, because you too are one of His little ones. Thanks be to God.
You take her light from your beautiful, restore, refine, Lord, you're merciful, redeem, revive, Spirit of God.
Oh Lord, thank you for your church, shown in each person, a body of believers colored by different personalities and faces, textured by a variety of ages, with each one shaped by the same God. Thank you, Lord, for the children of our church, and children the world over, eager and inquisitive. We pray for their health and their safety. Help us to learn from them, to be open to life and to be extravagant, even loud in our expression of joy, honest in the sharing of our needs with loved ones. Thank you also for young people, those who have never-ending quests of adventure for truth. Thank you for the way they value friends. We pray for them amid growing pains that come from new learnings in ever-changing circumstances. Help us to learn from young people and teenagers around us. Help us to embrace risk for new learnings and to renew relationships that feed our souls. Thank you also, O God, for the faithfulness of every adult that has ever connected their lives to this church in one way or another through decades of service and ministry. We pray for the temptations that often come in the middle years of life, that you would guide their decision-making and direct their paths of righteousness for your name's sake. We pray also for those whose lives have matured through the years and have mined the riches of life's wisdom, the depths of possibility, the fullness of life. Protect their physical health and continue to inspire them that they may continue to contribute and to lead by example. Almighty God of children and adults, of the aged and the young at heart, most of all, may your character be seen in the years that are ahead of us all. As surely as you have been gracious to us, grant your grace to the generations yet to come. For there is no one we want to be more like nor share with the world than Jesus. So send your Spirit to your church that we might shine in the darkness of these days, bringing hope. Refresh us with the living power of your word that those searching for truth will discover their lives blessed. And enable us through Christ alive in us that the world will be renewed in its love for all people, that the church will be engaged in its mission of peace for all nations, and that we might be inspired to believe again that all things are possible with God. So lead us again to that faith that can move mountains and can overcome whatever barriers may stand in the way of our loving and serving you with all of our hearts, souls, minds and strength, and for loving our neighbor as we love ourselves. And so, O God, may your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. In Jesus' name, amen. And now may the embrace of the Father be the comfort you desire. May the name of the Son be the one on whom you rely. May the presence of the Spirit be with you every hour. The three in one be the focus of all that you are, today and always. Amen.
Every word is a promise you keep.